So Justin, thank you for taking the time to chat.
My pleasure.
Let's just jump right in. For listeners, viewers, however people are going to consume this who might not be familiar with Dear White People, what is the show? What is Dear White People?
So Dear White People is a satirical comedy dramedy about a group of Black kids that attend a mostly white Ivy League college. It's an ensemble show about the many different sort of ways in which Black people sort of deal with racism, particularly in liberal white spaces. But at the center of it is a radio show called Dear White People, which has provoked a lot of reactions based on the title. That's kind of the starting off point for the show is something like Dear White People racist or mm-hmm. or is it social commentary? What does that mean? That's sort of a central question the show keeps asking.
So let's talk about that a little bit because, you know, the show is a lot of things. It's funny, it's entertaining, it's dramatic, but it is also dealing with like real life issues and has, you know, I wouldn't say it's didactic, but it has a clear message and a clear mission in ways that a lot of shows don't. Can you talk about just balancing all those different things when you're working on the show?
Yeah, I mean, the show's about a group of very articulate people who have a lot of things on their mind, who are very involved in social causes and activism. And so there's a lot of things that the show talks about. But at the end of the day, the show is almost always about identity versus self. It's about the fact that as people, we have roles that we play in society, and we also have to cultivate a sense of self, who we might really be. And what the show is pointing out is that for Black people, and Black people at other intersections like, you know, womanhood or being gay and Black or, you know, in some other way being marginalized as well as being Black, it points out that the identities that we get to occupy in society are so limited that we're forced into these situations that maybe people don't sort of realize we're going through. And it really is a call to see our humanity, but in an environment where everything is funny and everyone is sort of made fun of in an equal opportunity way. And there's a lot of social commentary in there too, both about white culture, but, you know, Black culture as well.
Obviously there's at the time we're recording this, there's a much larger conversation going on about racial injustice and all things related to that. And I know that the show is getting a little bit of extra attention during this time because people are looking for content from Black voices and Black creators. What has that been like, the renewed attention on the show? Has it been exciting? Has it been, you know, has there been a downside to it? What's that been like for you?
It's a mixed bag, you know. It's on a personal note, when the protests around George Floyd began to happen, I think I, along with every Black artist, is questioning, am I doing enough? Am I donating enough? Am I, you know, rallying enough? And to see the surge in viewership, which, you know, I think Netflix just put out that it's six times what it was in the week before, is really remarkable because it feels like, okay, well, maybe all that blood, sweat, and tears that we put into the show, which I think is pretty consistently undervalued and underlooked at by society at large, maybe I did make something that meets this cultural moment in some way. I know for me, it's been medicinal to go back and watch the show even before the surge in viewership, just to, you know, we deal with all of these issues, police brutality, what happens to a victim that becomes a public victim, that becomes a celebrity because of their victimhood, what it feels like to sort of need a Black hero that lets you down in the midst of oppression. I mean, we really go through all of the different sort of very complicated feelings that come out of these moments. And, we spend so much time making the show, and after we make it, it's you don't really revisit it because you spent so much time on it. And so for me, it's been nice to revisit it. And I made the thing and to remind myself what the show's about and, you know, to remind myself that other people know what I'm feeling too.
Not painting, you know, a lot of people find it difficult to watch their own stuff, but you're going back to it like and enjoying it, huh?
Yeah, I mean, I also find it really difficult, and it took me, you know, four seasons of making the show to actually do that. But we're on our final season, and I wanted to make sure I wasn't missing anything. And, but the thing that's really cool about Dear White People, and it's by design, it's not really just me. I'm a writer-director, but I write the show with a group of really talented writers, and we have amazing guest directors on the show. I mean, Academy Award-winning, world-class directors come to our show. You know, so watching it isn't really just sort of looking at my own sort of artistic choices. It's kind of refreshing myself because I really do invite a village of people to add their own personal statements to the show. I want everyone who works on the show to have a sense of ownership over what the show says. And I really encourage that. So the fun side of that is when I get to watch the show back, you know, there are moments that still absolutely surprise me.
Yeah, especially I imagine outside of the rush of production and everything, like being able to take
a step back. Being able to watch it without worrying about the deadline or the sound or whatever the, you know, the notes are, just to watch it as an audience member was a new experience for me.
That's super cool. Can you talk about putting together the writer's room for a show at the beginning of the season? You know, obviously the show deals with a lot of very heavy issues, you know, sometimes in it brings levity to them, but all the same, what do you look for when you're assembling a room, and what's a day in that room like?
Yeah, so for me, the most important thing is, because mostly, but you know, a lot of different kind of folks watch the show, but the group that comes to the show most often is Black women, who see themselves in Sam, Joelle, and Coco in particular. And so, really, the first priority for me in the writers' room is to make sure those voices are represented by Black women in the room, who are, have a lot, you know, who are Black women, but have many, 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 many other things about them that make them singular and unique and interesting. So that's always the first goal. And then, you know, I'm a gay Black man, so I kind of get where Lionel's at. So then the other goal is to make sure all the other characters in the show have some kind of representative in that room. I like putting together a team of people who don't necessarily agree with each other on every political or, you know, issue, but we all agree that we want to make a great show and we want to bring our best to it. And so it's a very irreverent room. We get into a lot of conversations that become episodes. We don't always agree with each other, which is, you know, kind of a way to keep the show from ever feeling preachy or didactic or, you know, like it's just hammering you with one point of view. And you know, there's a dedication to the work and to the craft of TV writing. And so it's a really fun room, but we work really hard. We work really, really hard. And we, you know, we have to sort of keep our finger on the conversation. We are very aware of what people say about the show, positive and negative. And every season is a bit of a reflection on how the last season was represented or received. So, you know, it's not the easiest room, but I think it's among the most fun, though, for sure.
I was, you know, in researching this, I had looked back at a couple of different interviews you had done, and you'd mentioned in one that you kind of view each season as its own sort of entity. It's like almost like each season's a reboot. And I'd wonder if you just talk a little bit more about that, like why take that approach and what do you think the benefits are of it?
Yeah, I mean, part of that approach has to do with the way, you know, the show functions. It's on a streaming platform. When we started at Netflix in 2016, streaming was still a wild, wild west. No one was really quite sure what it would become or amount to, but we knew that everyone was going to watch the thing, had the potential to watch the thing at once. It wasn't going to be coming out week to week. So for that first season, it was really important to me that you know, all 10 of those episodes felt contained in some way, that felt like if you were to watch them all at once, that would be a pleasant experience, and that would sort of make sense. And as it's gone on, you know, because our show, we find out if we're going to come back for a new season at the end of the season. So we can't sort of do things where we like plot out the next 4 years or the next, you know, we can't sort of do that on the show. So I try to make it so that each season is contained, but has a reason to continue. and that's, you know, part of that is just informed by the way in which the show is produced. But also because I come from the film world, and I get really bored with the idea that a television show ought to stay the same season to season, or that, you know, characters can't change, or that they can't ever overcome the original obstacles, because therefore the show loses its value and its meaning. I mean, these are sort of things that are ingrained in you when you learn about television writing. And I wanted to challenge just a little bit on that, because I think we are in a new world where audiences can accept a show evolving over time.
You mentioned, you know, coming from the feature role, and I wanted to sort of just take a step back and start at the beginning of the journey of Dear White People, because you go from crowdfunding like 25 grand to creating a movie that plays festivals and wins awards that turns into now 4 seasons of a show on Netflix. Just talk about that process for the beginning, you know, the inception of what Dear White People was through all this and what that's been like for you.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it really started in college. You know, I was in my senior year in film school. I knew that I needed to figure out what my first feature would be. And I was really frustrated because in mid-2005, I want to say it was when I was a senior, Black film and Black TV was it felt very monolithic, and it felt like there really wasn't a lot of room for diverse Black voices. It felt like as soon as there was one Black show or one Black movie that was doing well, you know, everyone sort of patted themselves on the back and went home. And the experience that I was having as a Black person was being a Black person among mostly white people and being in situations where I had to sort of constantly explain myself and defend my opinions and, you know, deal with what would eventually be called microaggressions, although at the time I didn't have that word. And I just wanted to get into that. I wanted to create something that felt like that and felt like what my life was made of. You know, I didn't feel like my Black experience was being reflected back to me in anything, really. And so, I don't know, I was just sitting and I just had this vision for like, what if I do an ensemble movie that's kind of like, you know, a Spike Lee movie or, you know, sort of like one of those big sprawling ensembles like a Nashville or an Election, where we sort of get into an issue from all these different perspectives. And from 2005 till about 2014, I just kept working on that feature script and I kept pushing it and I kept taking the next step until eventually something broke. So, you know, it was about a 9-year process of getting that script together and trying different things and trying to get audiences and all that stuff. And then eventually I made a concept trailer, put it online. It went really viral and got very popular. And the idea behind it was like, don't you all want a movie like this? Like, don't we miss this kind of movie? Like an ensemble art house movie that speaks to these issues? Well, if so, give us some money. and people really did. And eventually we were able to finance the whole feature, make the movie. But, you know, because it is an ensemble, just like, you know, Altman movies often would become, you know, like MASH is a great example of a movie that becomes a series. I knew that like that genre of the ensemble comedy where all of the characters were integral and important, I knew that that could work for TV. And then there were so many things that we didn't even get into in the movie because the movie is only an hour and 45 minutes. And so, you know, that's really, I was quite ready to turn it into a series when that opportunity presented itself. And I had been thinking about it, and I'd been thinking about like, how do we carry these characters forward and give them, you know, more canvas for people to get into their experiences. So MASH, for me, it was very organic, you know?
Yeah, no, MASH is a comparison that I totally had not thought of, but now that you mention it, it totally makes sense.
Yeah, a lot of Altman studying went into making both the movie and the series, I got to say, because there's very few guides to how to write ensembles. You know, when you're in film school, you're taught, you just write a single protagonist. You're just taught that, like, you just do that. Don't even think about other forms of narrative structure. You know, he was certainly very illuminating in that way to study his work.
You mentioned, you know, from like 2005 to 2014, you know, you're just kind of plugging away. You're working other jobs at that point. You're, you know, doing stuff to pay the bills. What was it, you know, what advice do you give to people, you know, who have that job, but also still have those passion projects they're trying to push through? Mm. What kept you going during that time?
Well, a couple things. You know, one, I think we're sort of conditioned, everyone, writers, Black folk, anybody who's really trying to break into an industry, we're all conditioned to sort of wait for permission. Or wait for the culture to sort of decide it's ready for what we have to say. And what I learned with Dear White People was really the first thing I tried to make that was purely motivated by the fact that I just wanted it and I wanted to see it. Everything I had tried to make before that was a little bit of that, but was calculated. It was like, well, I think this would be popular as a web series, or I think this would work in a pitch meeting. You know, I was trying to factor in the marketplace. And with Dear White People, I didn't do that at all. And it ended up being the thing that broke through, finally. So that's the first thing I would tell myself, is to really follow that thing that is burning inside of you that you're going to do no matter what, no matter how many times you hear no. Just do that thing, even if it's irrational, because maybe the point of it is to open up the market in ways that it wasn't open before. And to watch so many Black ensembles populated with articulate, funny millennials dealing with being Black in white spaces come through that door after Dear White People in just 6 short years. For me, has been proof that is the perspective a person should have when trying to create new work. And you know, and the other thing is to sort of treat it like a real job. I mean, I had a full-time job. I was working in PR and publicity. I was working on really big film campaigns. But I just decided, like, well, this is at least going to be a part-time job, which means that I need to dedicate this many hours, no matter what, to it. It means that, no, I can't really hang out on the weekends or at night. Like, I've got to put in my work and I've got to write and treat it like it already is a job, even though it's not paying me any money right now. So those are the two pieces of advice that actually ended up really working for me.
What's your writing process like? Are you you wake up, you pound out pages, you have to set strict deadlines for yourself? What is your typical process like?
It alternates. When there is a real deadline, you know, with a paycheck usually attached to it, I can become very, very disciplined. When it is sort of an amorphous idea, I like to give myself some time in the beginning to sort of put it together however I want. Sometimes that involves free writing. Sometimes that involves essaying. Sometimes that involves just watching a bunch of movies. I try to give myself space to be both free and disciplined. And then especially when it's something that I'm doing on my own and there isn't a paycheck, at some point I do have to apply a deadline to it, even if it's arbitrary. I'll tell myself, you know, I've got 1 month to finish this script because I really want to get it out in time. I'll just make something up in my head. Sometimes I'll buy myself something that I really want as like a present on the other end of it. But I think for me, the key has been to not really stick to one thing. You know, I love people who are like, I get up every single day and I write. And that works for me. But it doesn't work for me every single day out of the year. So it ebbs and flows. And because I'm also a writer director, some ideas are kind of informed visually first or informed by music or informed by other things other than writing. So I just try to give myself space to do all those things.
And are you someone who, and again, maybe your answer is going to be just yes, all of these things, but are you someone that finds that you need a strong outline? Do you, you know, write in order, or do you just kind of, you know, go where you're feeling on the day?
I cannot go where I'm feeling on the day. I mean, I got to do both. I got to have a really, really strong outline. I've got to really understand the guts of the story. I'm a story nerd. I'm obsessed with like how stories like move, you know, us and how they elicit emotions. And so I'm always reading some very thick, dense book about story structure and theory. And so like, there's a part of me that really has to have that stuff figured out. What is the theme? What do these characters represent in our psyches? Like, I really like to go there. And then I have that work done. And then I just show up and I start writing and give myself the freedom to stick to that outline or veer away, knowing that like, if I have a tangent, if I decide to write a scene I didn't plan for, I still have the outline to help kind of anchor me to what it is the point of this thing is. And I just try to let both processes kind of play off of each other. The part of me that just wants to be free and write whatever I want, and the part of me that really needs like a very strict, you know, kind of structure and sort of target in mind. Because I think something good comes from both of those parts of, you know, how my brain works.
Yeah, totally makes sense. We're getting close to the end here. It's kind of unavoidable. Everybody's been kind of staying at home for the last 3 months because of crazy circumstances of global pandemic. How has that affected you? What has your writing life been like in the time of COVID?
Well, I mean, there are many terrible things about the pandemic, but one of them that isn't so terrible for me is the lockdown, because I'm an introvert. And so, you know, one thing that was, you know, helpful is a weird phrase to use, but one thing that was kind of helpful was the fact that we still had 10 episodes to write for season 4 of Dear White People. So I had something to do every day. I had a room to lead and I had scripts to write and scripts to finish. And, you know, so for me, it's actually been a bit restorative to sort of not have to do everything in person, to be able to have time to just sit in the clothes that I slept in and sort of write freely. You know, there is a bohemian sort of lifestyle that I really, really have enjoyed. And it just gives me time to think, time to watch things, time to pontificate and ruminate. And, you know, to me, the best part about writing is writing just to write, writing with no idea how this is going to become something. I just need to write this. And I have plenty of time to do that part of it, as well as the sort of like, I'm writing because I have to turn this in because this has to be a scene and it has to be funny and it has to work. And having time to do both, I think has really made my work better. It certainly made my experience of working better. So hopefully that translates into something that audiences will enjoy too.
And what about the Zoom writer? I assume your writer's room was meeting via Zoom. What was that process like for the in-person room?
I mean, it was great Zooming just because it felt like, okay, well, we have something to do every day. We sort of have a structure to the day. But I have to tell you, writing over Zoom is exhausting in ways that like don't really make any sense. You just sort of think, well, I'm at home, I'm comfortable, I can eat whatever I want, my cat is here. Like, why am I so stressed out? But there's something about the eye contact. You're either always looking at yourself or you're looking at someone else. You can't ever look away. You're so focused on the conversation in a way that in a writer's room, you really aren't. Like in a writer's room, people are talking and there's a conversation happening, but you've got a phone you can look at. There's a bathroom you can go to. There's a snack room. Like there's just, there are little mini breaks throughout the day that you can take. And in Zoom, it's like, no, it is razor sharp focus. We are having a conversation. And so it is, I found myself at the end of the day, just being so exhausted and knowing that all I did was sit in front of my computer. It was very disorienting in that way. So I like it. I'm not going to mind the in-person writer's rooms though. When we start to open back up, I do miss that part of it.
Yeah, that makes sense. All right. So we're close to the end here. One last question.
Sure.
You sort of touched on this when I was asking you about, you know, working the side hustle and keeping yourself driven as a writer, but is there anything you've learned along the way that you wish, you know, you go back to that film student or even before then, you could tell that person at the beginning of their career?
I would just say, you know, listen to the rules that people give you, but know that they really are kind of BS. I mean, everything informs my writing, not just sort of like save the cat or like, this is three arc structure or whatever. Like everything I read and think about and absorb informs my writing in a real way. It allows me to write more personally and to write things that are different than what's already out there. And so, you know, I think that people really should be more encouraged to follow their own instincts alongside learning the rules. Yes, learn the rules because you need to know where everyone else thinks the rules are at. But the truth is there aren't any rules. And nothing is wasted as a writer. Everything you experience, everything you read, everything you love, even if it's tacky. I mean, like if you watch the show, it's obvious that we're obsessed with the Housewives. It's obvious that we're sort of like, you know, super into drag queen competition shows. Like we, you know, our obsessions are both profound and really lowbrow, and they all make the work rich. And so I would just say, like, on top of the hustle, on top of like getting it done and breaking in, like give yourself some time to just sort of figure out what you're into and what the areas in which you're just weird and the areas in which you think differently, because all of that stuff is going to really inform the work in a positive way too. And you can't help it when you're a writer. It just folds in.
Yeah, no, I love that. I think everybody should incorporate as much Real Housewives into their possible. Justin, well, thank you so much for
your time. Lead.
Just remind everybody where they can watch the show.
Okay, so Dear White People is on Netflix, and the water's warm, man. Viewership is up, I think, 600%. So you're in good company if you're just now starting.
Sounds good. Thanks again, Justin.
All right, thank you so much.